This week, we'll talk about the Flames-Oilers trade and break down which team we think got the best of the deal. We'll look at where Olivier Waugh fits in the Flames' depth chart and who he thinks an ideal defensive partner for Ladislav Smid. Is there really a positive to the Flames' tough road trip, and could losing actually be good for development? Plus, we'll ask if Barra has earned himself a spot on the team this year, and we'll look at some of the Flames' prospects and how they're doing in their respective leagues. All this and more this week on Fireside Chat. This is episode 28, Goalies Are Such an Enigma, recorded November 11th, 2013.
Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat, featuring Dan, Matt, and Lucas.
Welcome back for another episode of Fireside Chat. Tonight it's just myself, Dan, alongside Matt. And I think right off the top of the show, we have a pressing issue to talk about, and that was the Flames trade that happened on Friday. The Flames did their first deal of the season and their second deal in history with our neighbors to the north, the Edmonton Oilers. This is a deal that saw the Flames send Roman Horak and Laurent Brossois to the Oilers in exchange for Ladislav Smid and Olivier Waugh. And Matt, I want to get your thoughts on this because I know that you've been a big fan of Laurent Brossois. What do you think?
Well, it's one of those things that with the Flames depth chart being what it is, we can easily afford to lose guys like Horak and Brossois, even though they're decently talented prospects. You know, getting someone that is an established top four defenseman in the NHL that's only 27, you know, we're talking about sending a couple of players that are in the middle of our depth chart, you know, in the mid-teens. You know, it's not like we sent a guy like Jankowski or something. So, yeah, I can't really complain. And, you know, getting Olivier Waugh back as well, you know, with goalies, you just never know if they'll actually develop. So, you know, it gives us another shot at possibly finding somebody that's decent.
Yeah, when I first saw this deal Friday, I was sitting at work and it came through and I was quite impressed by the deal. We've talked about our thoughts about the Oilers and who's running the Oilers in the past. And really, I think that we managed to get a great deal out of the Oilers. I mean, I know they had to clear some cap room to bring in Brizgalov, but I kind of broke this down as skater for skater, goalie for goalie. I think if you look at it that way and you say that we trade Horak for Smid, that's a heck of a deal. I mean, we trade a guy who's mostly been a fringe player at best with the Flames and mostly an AHL guy. Would you agree with that assessment in Horak?
Yeah, pretty much. And with additions like Colborne and Knight and several other players, realistically, Horak getting a shot in Calgary was not going to happen. Yeah.
No. And being able to move him for a top four defenseman, an established NHL defenseman, is a heck of a move.
Yeah, well, especially considering our prospect core amongst the defensemen, it's rather weak beyond Seeloff and Weatherspoon. Like, all the other players, Kanzig, Kulak, Culkin, they all have weaknesses in their game where, like, they need to take a step or two forward in their development in order to actually become NHL caliber players. So getting a guy like Smid, in addition to guys like Weidman and Giordano and Brody, like, it doesn't mean that you have to rush the kids. Like, there's no real necessity to, you know, rush a guy before he's ready because, oh, we need a defenseman right now. So, in that manner, I think it was a brilliant trade.
Yeah, and when I look down our roster, I am seeing, really, that I think we had a hole in defense.
Oh, most definitely.
I think that bringing in a guy like Smid can definitely help with that. Not only now, but for the long term. I mean, we have the cap room. We can bring Smid in. And I think he's going to fill an instant role here that will work, that will, you know, we need filled for a long time.
Well, also,
and I can see him as a Flame for the long term, you know, three, I don't know how long his contract is, but I can see him re-signing here. I think he's going to be with this team for a while.
His contract's up in three, you know, he has three more seasons beyond this one.
So that's a long-term Flame, yeah, right there.
And realistically, at the trade deadline, you know, other UFA types like Stajan and Stempniak and even Camilleri might get dealt. And we're actually so close to the cap floor that we actually needed to add somebody, you know, to in order to stay above the floor if we were to trade those guys down the road. So, you know, it's a good thing that we got him, because it'll help facilitate other moves down the road if we're actually going to sell off some of our UFAs.
Yeah, it's a good point, too. And, you know, I think going back to Horak and the fact he's a fringe player, I've been thinking about this since the trade happened, and I wonder if Flames fans... perhaps overvalued Horak and his role on this team simply because of the way that we acquired him.
Mm-hmm.
He was part of the deal for Tim Erickson, who is supposed to be, you know, the next big Flames player, the next, you know, big Flame prospect. And we traded him away to the Rangers and got Horak and a couple draft picks. So I think that people might have saw kind of Horak being that next Tim Erickson. And I think that he may have been looked at differently or perhaps overvalued in people's minds because of that.
Well, the thing with Horak is that he thinks the game exceptionally well, and the problem is that he doesn't have the actual talent to become what he could be. You know, like, his shot's not exceptional, his passing ability's not exceptional. You know, he'd be a good, like, fourth line guy because he reads the play so well, but, you know, like, there's limited offensive potential, and it's because of the fact that he had such a good on-ice vision that people might have thought there was more there than was actually there.
Yeah, and, you know, I think that's something that we have to do in a rebuild, and I've said this before, is we have to audition guys. And in this case, we auditioned Horak. They realized that, yeah, the depth chart is strong. We can not necessarily need to get rid of him, but there's value in him. So let's capitalize on their value, move him out, and bring in a piece that we need. And I think that's something we have to do in a rebuild, is we can't let anyone just kind of say, oh, well, you've been with this team for a few years, so you're on the roster, you know, for you've got a roster spot already.
Yeah, well, realistically, the Flames have about a dozen forward prospects that are equivalent to Horak or better, which does sound a little strange considering the depth of our team in the past, but, yeah, like, you go down the list of guys like Monahan, Berchi, Poirier, Klimchuk, Jankowski, Gaudreau, Granlund, like, on and on and on and on, and, like, how is he going to get ice time, especially when the prospects that are ahead of him are going to be fighting amongst the veterans to actually get ice time. So, you know, getting rid of him in exchange for an area of weakness is just good asset management.
Yeah. So one thing that I thought as soon as I saw this deal is I thought, you know what? This has a Brian Burke fingerprint on it. I mean, Ladislav Smid played for Burke in Anaheim. And bringing him back here and making this kind of move, does it seem like a Berkey move to you?
Yes and no. Like, yeah, he did play.
If it was a Feaster move, he would have got rid of a draft pick.
And not necessarily. Like, you know, I think that the labeling of, oh, this was a Burke move or this was a Feaster move is kind of irrelevant because, you know, like, if you bring a new person in, they might point out something about certain players that they see in them, but that's not necessarily going to dictate that, oh, we need to go get this guy specifically. Like, you know, the Oilers apparently were shopping Smid for about 3 weeks prior to the trade, so, you know, I think it was more them wanting to get rid of the contract, you know, because they've got all the young kids to sign for $6 million instead of, you know, a top four defenseman.
Well, I mean, the biggest thing there, I think, if you look at the salary cap, is Smid was making about $3 million. He got moved out. Brizgalov got brought in for the same $3 million. So I think that the Oilers were just trying to dump salary to bring Brizgalov in.
Yeah, and it's one of those things, like, you know, in the coming seasons, like, guys like Yakupov are going to start needing their big contracts because, of course, they do. So,
Panini stays in North America.
Yeah, well, I think with him, you'd actually need to give him $6 million just to keep him here. But that's neither here nor there. But you know, they have to fill out an actual team, and if they've got so many players that are signed for $6 and $7 million, and you got a quality number four guy on the defense taking up $3.5 million, well, that's a little much. You know, that said, it is Edmonton, and since when have they ever done anything that's smart? Well, you know, like, even the Oiler fans, like, a lot of them were complaining heavily about both the return and why they sent him out. So, yeah, like, when most of your fan base is scratching your head, you know, usually that's not a good thing.
It's true. It's true. But, you know, we've had some deals in the past, people are scratching their head, and they turned out being good in the long term. So I guess we'll have to see. I mean, I think a lot of this hinges on Horak's development and Brassois' development. And speaking of Brassois, you've been our big Brassois supporter on this show. What are your thoughts on moving him out?
It is disappointing whenever you get rid of somebody that has actual potential. But realistically, if you look at guys like Berra and Gillies, and especially Gillies, you know, like you can get rid of a guy that's a notch or two down from in potential than Gillies. Like, Gillies looks like he could be a all-star caliber goalie in the NHL. So, you know, with having someone like that in the prospect stable, you know, you can move out a guy like Brassois.
You have a bit more flexibility.
It's not like Brassois was the only ticket in town. So, you know, like, realistically, no. He was third or fourth on the prospect depth chart behind Berra and Gillies, and in a dogfight with Ordeo. So, you know, while all four of those guys are good, you know, having three guys that are arguably ahead of them in the, you know, in potential and development, you know, you can sacrifice the number four guy. And, like, that's why you need a good prospect base. Like, on CP, I was, in the summer, I was saying that, like, in order to build a cup contender, you need, like, 20 players that are equivalent in potential to guys like Jankowski and Monahan, like, in that range. And that's because you're going to need to make trades as well. And, you know, sometimes you'll have several good quality guys, but you need a star player, so you send a couple of your lower guys out to get that star player that you need to put you over the top. Sort of like what the Kings did with sending Simmons and Shen to the Flyers for Mike Richards. You know what I mean? So having that kind of depth where you can actually make a trade and not hurt yourself long term, it's all good.
Well, I think in any sport, that's the key. I mean, the more prospect depth you can have, the more good prospect depth you can have, not just bodies taking up your 50 contracts in this case, the better off you're going to be, because it means you either have more chances to get a top-level player yourself or more chances to make a deal to get something that you need down the road.
And the thing is, it's not like we traded for a 35-year-old defenseman. Like, Smead's just entering his NHL prime, you know, so
Smead's still under 30, and he fills a need we have.
He's only 27. You know, like, by the time his contract's up, he'll be Weidman's age. Like, you know, and you can sign him for another 3 years, and there wouldn't be a problem with that. So, you know what I mean? Like,
very true. And I mean, I've seen Olivia Waugh play in the AHL, both live and on TV, and watching some games online. And I really like him. I think that he's going to be a goaltender that's going to push Ordeo for the AHL job, which I think Ordeo probably needs right now. And a guy I think we will see in this organization for at least a couple of years, depending on whether he can crack the lineup or they get rid of him. But, I mean, he's only 22. He's a goaltender that has a long way to go before we get to see anything as far as potential goes. Yeah.
Well, especially with him only being 22, you know, like, if you keep him for another 2 years or so, if he doesn't show any progression by then you probably look to cut ties with him. But goalies are really a crapshoot. You just never know when they're going to figure it all out. So, you know, it's always good to get more darts to throw at the board. Eventually one will hit.
Yeah, very true. And, you know, I mean, it's one of these things with the goalies. I don't think that we necessarily added or subtracted. I think we got a goalie who's perhaps a little bit further along in his development, and perhaps is less of an unknown because of that. We've seen him play at the AHL level. We know more of what we're getting with him. And maybe the Flames said at this point, that's what they want, is they want goalies right now in their system who they know more of what they're getting.
Yeah. Well, at worst, you know, he's just a fill-in guy. You know, like guys like Matt Keatley before. You know, like I think the Oilers were really interested in Brossoit, and, like, that's what instigated the trade. And, you know, like, we still need goalies, so, you know, as long as we keep adding...
Somebody's got to backstop the ECHL, yeah, right?
Like, as long as we keep adding about one goalie every year until we get somebody that's a credible replacement for Kipper, then it's all good, you know, so...
And to me, this does nothing but helps the goaltenders, because you've got him, you got Barra, you got some guys who are coming up through the system. I think it pushes them all to be better, to have to keep their job, not be a guy sort of like Keatley, like you said, who's just kind of there because, well, we need a spot, and we've got somebody between Ordeo and Waugh and Gillies. I think they're all going to be pushing each other to be the best they can be.
Well, the thing is that... seeing how Barra played in his first three games, Romo, the game after, that was by far his best performance as a Flame, you know, against the Avs. So having that kind of a competition where there is an actual starting position where you can actually make $4 or $5 million if you take the job, you know, like, that's a huge incentive for all of these guys. So... You know, like, they're going to be...
Oh, for sure. I think it's a big incentive for anybody.
Yeah, because, like, if you don't have any competition, you can get a little lackadaisical. But if you have, you know, legitimate competition, you know, that will help to elevate your game. And you just don't know, you know, until you get there if that elevation is sustainable. But, you know, hopefully with Romo and Barra pushing each other and Ordeo looking very good in Abbotsford, that between the three of them, like, they all push each other to new heights, and, you know, we might actually get some NHL goaltending out of them.
Yeah, and, you know, even if, like you said, you can push them, you know, and it doesn't last, or it's not sustainable, but you can push somebody for a year, maybe 2 years. I hate to say it, but you can almost use them and discard them. You know, okay, we saw the best play we're ever going to see from this guy. Now let's, you know, move them on and bring somebody else in that role. So not everybody that's here has to be a long-term solution.
Oh, no. And that's the thing, that unless they become, like, a legit top-tier goalie, then they're expendable. And, you know, like, I'm talking at least, like, the Wongo caliber, you know, of a legit good goalie. And, you know, if they don't provide that, then move on to the next guy. And so on until we actually do get somebody that's that good. And, you know, like, that's not something that's going to happen overnight, of course. But, you know, like, over 2 or 3 years, we need to make a concerted effort to try goalies to see if we can actually get a star goalie in. So that way, once our forwards and defensemen develop, that, you know, we might actually have a cup-contending caliber of team instead of, you know, Edmonton.
Well, I'd argue maybe we don't need to bring in a starting goalie, but we need to perhaps develop starting goalie to bring someone in with some raw talent like a Waugh or a Barra and make them into that starter.
Yeah. And or Gillies or Orio. Like, yeah, you just don't know. Like, Pekka Rinne, when he first started with Nashville, like, the first time I saw him live, like, Calgary scored 6 goals on him in, like, 1 period. And it's like, how is this guy going to ever be a legitimate NHL goaltender? And flash forward 3 years, and he gets signed for 7 years, $49 million. So, you know what I mean? Like, you just don't know.
Yeah, well, and then you go the other way as well. You get a guy like Breezegalov, who looked good when he was young, and then fell off the map, couldn't get signed, got a job in the ECHL, and now his last saving hope is the Oilers organization. So, yeah, it can go either way.
Goalies are such an enigma.
And that's why I think the more of them we have that we think are potentially NHL-ready, the better shot we're going to have later on at having a successful goalie.
Oh, yeah, most definitely.
So, before we get off the trade, overall, would you say so far, I mean, obviously we haven't seen development, but just based on what we know, thumbs up or thumbs down for the Flames on this one?
Oh, hands down, a definite 100% win. You know,
I agree.
Like, we gave up 2 prospects that are in the mid-teens in our depth chart for a legit top 4 defenseman. Like, give me a break.
Well, and you know, I saw a lot of chatter online. I was talking to people on Twitter through our account. I was talking to people on Facebook and also on different forums who said the Flames shouldn't give up prospects. But like you said, since you have to give up something to get something, in this case, we got a bona fide NHL player for a fringe prospect. I mean, at best, a fringe prospect who we can easily replace with someone else on this roster. Corbin Knight comes to mind. So I think the Flames made out really well in this deal. And if we could acquire more guys for that same cost, the Flames aren't going to be, you know, in the troubles they're in for that.
Oh, no. And, like, especially considering that 3 teams are already into the, like, their injury reserve. And, like, another dozen or so teams are, like, within $1 million of the upper end of the cap. You know, they're gonna, if they're needing to make a trade or something, or they want to add players at the deadline, maybe we can snag another Smid-level player off of them to help facilitate other deals on their end. So, you know, because we have the most cap space in the NHL, so, like, we can just do whatever the heck we want. And we actually
well,
do
I mean,
have...
the other thing you can do in that case, too, is we can take bad contracts back and require a prospect to come in as kind of the price of doing business, if you will.
And realistically, we have enough actual prospects, especially in the forward group, that, you know, if we, say, get another opportunity to get someone like Smid that's, like, that caliber of player for... you know, say, like, Hanowski and Reinhardt, well, why not? You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
It's not
and
like
I also
we're
think that bringing in guys of Horak's caliber isn't a hard thing to do. I think you could easily get them thrown in another trade, and if we can then flip them for something, I think that's, you know, that could be the Flames, I guess, MO for the next couple of years is bringing in young players and then flipping them, you know, whether it's as one or in a package for more experienced players to get us out of this rebuild.
If you look at the other trades that we made with getting guys like Colborne, Russell, Knight, and whomever, Gagliardi, there you go. Each of those guys is getting more ice time, and, like, their value has risen to the point where if we traded them for multiple fourth round picks we'd be getting ripped off. And, like, that's already. So, you know, like, we can always flip assets like those guys or the guys that they're eking out in the depth chart and replace some of our prospect depth that way as well. So, having actual depth is always a good thing. And it opens up so many doors.
I think that's probably the takeaway from this whole conversation is the deeper the Flames can be, the more options they're going
to
have.
Because we have to bargain hunt. And, you know, guys like Russell and Colborne, they're not going to get ice time elsewhere because they're in win-now modes. And, you know, they can't rely on a rookie that's trying to figure his game out when, you know, they make one mistake and there goes their season. So, you know, where Calgary, it doesn't really matter. It's not like we're making the playoffs anyway. Make as many mistakes as long as you learn from them. So we can bargain hunt, hope that they actually develop, and then, if necessary, use them in a trade down the road. That's how...
Even if they don't develop, you can often still trade them because somebody will see something there.
And worst case scenario, you burn a lower round pick or a 12th and 17th prospect like Horak and Brossoit were rated by CP. So, you know, that's the kind of moves that you have to make. And you buy low and you try to sell high. Like, guys like Stempniak, Stajan, and Camilleri, you could easily get a second-round pick for the first two guys, and likely a first-plus for Camilleri at the trade deadline, right? So, like, why not go that route, and you can get some more high-end talent with those picks, you know what I mean? Like, instead of...
So, Matt, who would you, just kind of moving to Ladislav Smid for a minute... Who would you pair him up with in his first couple games of Flame?
That's actually a really tough one because, like, I've liked the top four of Brody, Butler, Weidman, and Russell.
Well, that's it. It's tough because when you think something's working, you don't want to change it. If Luke was here, we know that he'd probably say, you know, wherever Butler is, scratch Butler, put Smid in.
Actually, that would probably be the last one that I would move just because Butler's actually been playing good and you don't know if he's found the right niche and he's actually going to develop into the player we were hoping we're going to get. So, like, I'd leave him alone just to see if this is just a, like, 10-game hot streak or there's actually something there. I'd almost like to see him paired with Weidman, but... You know, but that's really tough. So, you know.
I mean, if I don't look at pairing so far and just look at who I think would be a good partner for him, I think Weidman would be a good partner. I also think that he might be able to get something really good out of Shane O'Brien.
Yeah, that's where I'd likely start him is with O'Brien. Just, you know, like until the first two pairings start faltering a bit. You know what I mean? Because, like, Smid still needs time to learn the system and all that.
Yeah.
So, you know, kind of easing him in a bit and then increasing his ice time down the road might be the better way of going about it.
Yeah, and I mean, you could always put Smid on a special teams lineup as well and pair him with different guys there to try him out as a power player, a PK guy.
Yeah, exactly.
So I think that's probably everything we need to talk about with the trade. I think we're both agreeing it's a good deal up front, and we'll see how it ends up working out for us down the road. But I'm really excited to see Smid play this week, and I'm happy to see him here as a Flame. Speaking of seeing him play, what were your thoughts on this last road streak? The Flames have been on a 4-game road streak and really haven't done too well. Of 4 games, they came away with only 2 points.
Actually,
so 8 possible.
I thought that they played exceptionally well, except for the Minnesota game and the first period of the Blues game. You know, realistically, the Flames are not going to be able to beat the top teams consistently. And the fact that we beat Chicago and we nearly came back against St. Louis, and we nearly came back against Colorado. Like, that's encouraging. Like, yeah, it would have been better if we got more points, but you have to take the silver linings of we actually held our own, and we looked like credible competition for them. It wasn't that, like, their goalies gave up stinker goals, and, like, that's how we were in it. You know, because, you know, like, it's difficult with a rebuilding team. Like, it's easy to get frustrated that, oh, they lost again, you know, but
that's what we're expecting. I mean, we all said that at the beginning of the year, this is a rebuilding team. Expect the losses to outweigh the wins.
Yeah, and with the play of the players, like, you could see that everybody was trying to do their best. Like, yeah, the wheels came off a bit in Minnesota, but, you know, that does happen with rebuilding teams. So
that happens with even non-rebuilding teams. I mean, we've seen sometimes the top teams just have a bad game once in a while.
Oh, yeah. Like, I remember the Flames getting blown out by teams like Nashville and San Jose, like 9-1 and stuff like that. It happens, but, you know, as long as the kids are playing consistently and, like, giving a good effort all the time, that's the important thing. Like, seeing Backlund step up with a couple of very good plays against Colorado, that was very good. So, it's small things. You know, you can't take, you know, the end result and, like, that's the be-all and end-all of the game. It's the little things, whether the players are actually engaged and trying or if they're dogging it, you know, and
and I think it was probably just honestly disappointing for most people coming off a great 3-2 win to then have a 5-1 loss. And I think that really soured a lot of people.
Well, even then, it was more of a 2-1 game until like 10 minutes left. And then
That's true, yeah. It was right in that halfway point in the third period where the wheels just fell right off.
Yeah, like there was one really bad defensive play that led to the third goal, and then it's like they just gave up entirely. So, you know, like,
and this is, I think, a good look at how Bob Hartley's handling this team. Like you said, they fell apart at the end there. They weren't playing a great game in Minnesota the whole game, but they didn't fall apart till the end. They weren't great for the first part of the Blues game, but I think it was Bob Hartley that was able to get them back on track, get them more focused. They finished up the Blues game really strong, and I thought they played a great game in Colorado.
Yeah, and the thing is that just from a pure talent standpoint, the Flames only have two or three guys that you can call legitimate top six forwards at the moment because guys like Glenn Cross and Stempniak are hurt. So with that lack of depth, and then you're going up against teams that are firing on all cylinders that have, you know, five or six legitimate top six forwards, and, you know, they're going full bore trying to win a cup. You know, you're not going to often be able to contain and beat those kind of teams. So, you know, like, yeah, it's frustrating that you lose, but, you know, as long as you're sticking with them, at least, then that's a win in and of itself.
Yeah, and, you know, there's, my old minor league coach told me this. There's learning to be done from losing. When you lose, it makes you look more critically at yourself. When you're winning, you think, oh, we're doing everything right. But when you lose, it makes you look critically at yourself, and it helps you look at your game from a different angle and perhaps better figure out what needs to be changed the next time around.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And the thing is that the players that are coming up, like, they need to realize that, like, when they do make mistakes, that this is how you fix that. And then go up there and respond and learn from that and grow as a player. And the ones that do, they'll likely be long-term pieces for us. And the ones that don't, you look at possibly moving for another piece. So, you know, it's one of those things that it's really difficult to say that, oh, this guy's going to be here long-term or that guy. Because you just don't know how they're going to respond to the whole developmental process.
No, that's very true. So looking ahead, I guess, we looked back at the road swing and we both agreed, you know, we had some losses, but it wasn't, I think, as bad as a lot of people think it was. Looking ahead, how do you think the Flames are going to do this week? They have a 3-game homestand against the Sharks, the Stars, and the Oilers.
Well, realistically, they're going to likely have troubles with each of those three teams. So, you know, like even the Oilers, just because, you know, they tend to play a bit better when they're against us. But, you know, they just have to go out and play their game. Like, I'm not even focused on getting points at this point. You know, just go out there and try to improve your play. You know, like, that's all...
More great learning moments.
Yeah, that's all I care about. Because, realistically, this season's likely already in the books for playoffs. So, you know, getting improvements through learning will help next year and the year beyond. And help accelerate the rebuilding experience instead of, you know, going around in circles. So, yeah, that's all I'm looking forward to, is them continuing to learn good habits.
Yeah, and I think we've said since the beginning of the season, that's all we can expect. It's for the Flames to establish a system, get guys working in the system. If they can't move those guys out and see who really wants to be here, and I think part of seeing that is to see who can put up with the losses. Matt, one thing I was talking to a couple people about this week and wanted to get your thoughts on it. The idea was floated this week, and I never really thought of it until I started having a conversation with a couple fans on Twitter about this. But the Flames have struggled not only over the last week, but the last little bit. I mean, probably, you know, even before the road trip, they lost to Detroit. We've had a lot of players coming in and out of the lineup in the last week and a half with injuries and guys getting healthy. Do you think that part of the challenges the Flames might be facing right now is just their lineups are all changing again?
Well, the thing is that losing guys like Stempniak and Glenn Cross, and even before that Giordano, is that we don't have anybody that's a legitimate replacement for those guys, because we don't have that much top-end depth. So, you know, like, when you lose three of your top six players, you know, it's difficult to really respond to that. So, well, we've seen in years gone by, like, our second and third liners would get hurt, like, the team would magically go on a losing streak because there's just nobody there to replace them. So having a bunch of new players in and out of the lineup is going to cause some issues as well. So, yeah, it wouldn't surprise me if that's part of the problem.
And I think not only just having the top-line guys out, but, I mean, if you look at the beginning of this season, the team had really good chemistry, and a lot of that was that the coaching staff was really working with these players in their lines. I mean, they're having them practice together. They're having them doing stuff off the ice together. And I think it could also be that, hey, our lines are changing. And now we need to spend some more time getting to know these new guys, figuring out how we work together, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. And that's all part of the learning process, really. So, well, we've even seen guys like Monahan start and Colborn both slowing down a bit after they got hot for a bit there. So, rebuilding teams are going to have major ups and downs like that. It's just part of the whole fun process.
It's part of what we can expect from a rebuild.
Yeah.
So while we're also talking about a rebuild and players that deserve to be here, let's talk a bit about the goaltending. The first question I wanted to ask you is around the goaltending battle. Do you think that Barra has earned himself a spot with the Flames all year?
Oh, most definitely. Actually, I think he might have ended up winning a spot maybe even next year and beyond. With how he's been playing, like, if he's at all consistent with his efforts, then, like, I think we have a quality middle-of-the-road starter in him. Like, I've been that impressed by him. Like, he's still learning his angles a bit, but, you know, that's any goalie that's adjusting is going to have that problem. So, you know, I think he's a long-term possibility. Like, at worst, like, he'd be a quality 1B. Like, if, say, Gillies comes in next year and tears up the show and steals the number one job, like, at worst, Barrow will be a very good backup, so...
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing. I don't know. I don't want to say how many games I think he'll play this year, how many games he's earned this year, if you will, but I think he's definitely earned himself a spot on this team, be it as a one guy or a number two guy or a 1B guy. Yeah, I think he'll be here this year. I think he'll probably be here next year. And I think, as you said earlier in the show, I think it's going to make Kerry Ramo have to work that much harder to prove his worth and prove that he deserves to stay here as well.
Yeah, exactly. Because, you know, if you're coming in and, like, your mindset's like, I'm going to be the starter this year, which Ramos likely was, you know, having someone else come in and steal the job for you, well, you're going to try that much harder to get it back, because... realistically, you're going to want an NHL starter's paycheck. And, you know, if Barra's stepping in the way of that, well, you're going to try and elevate your game to try to take the job back off of him. So, yeah, like, it's one of those things where it's a very good thing that we have this kind of competition. And, you know, I wish that each position had that kind of competition. Because the cream of the crop will rise to the top, and, you know, that's how you get through your rebuild. Well, like we said earlier,
if they're both hot and we can't keep them both, we'll trade one of them.
Yeah, and that's worst case scenario is you take the second guy and move him for something else. Because other teams, like you look at Anaheim and Ottawa. Like, Ottawa, they had Anderson, Leonard, and Bishop. Well... you know, they got three spots for two guys, and Anderson's a really good goalie. Leonard's finally developing, so they trade Bishop off, and he's now becoming a good starter in Tampa Bay. And Anaheim, they got Hiller and Fast, who are both very good goalies, and then Anderson comes in because Fast got hurt, and he's won his first six games in the NHL. So, you know, which likely makes one of the other guys expendable. So, you know,
that's really the position you want to be in as a team. As much as you hate to have to get rid of assets, you want to be in the place where you have to move an asset because you just have too many good assets.
Exactly. And, you know, like if down the road, Ramo or Barra is good enough where we can get a decent prospect like a Corey Conacher or Matt Fratton in a second round pick, well, that's a very good thing. So, you know, I don't really care, it's all good. The more talent we have, the better off we'll be. So
for sure, yeah,
it's all good.
Staying on the topic of goalies, I'm actually surprised the Abbotsford Heat have played Joey McDonald twice since he got sent down. I wasn't expecting him to get much play time at all. He's played in two games, and he has two wins under his belt. So I'm not surprised he's winning at that level. I mean, we all said that he's an NHL mainstay. But I guess I also wanted to ask you, what do you think about the Flames perhaps bringing Ordeo up? Do you think that Ramo has to worry that his job might be in jeopardy, that they might swap him for McDonald again, or they might swap him for Ordeo?
If Ramo is as bad as he was in the first couple of games that he played, then he might have something to worry about, especially if Ordeo keeps up his .944 save percentage. So, you know, it's all good. You know, we have so much good talent coming through the pipeline in the goalie position that, you know, like, Gillies, he's throwing down a under 2 goals against average and like .950 save percentage, which is, I think, tops in the NCAA. You got Ordeo, who's playing absolutely fantastic down in Abbotsford. And you got Barra, who's looking like a legit NHL goalie, too. So, you know,
And now we've got Olivier Wan in the mix as well.
Yeah, so, you know, it's all good.
I can't see Ramo losing the job this year. I think he's, if for no other reason than his salary right now, I think that he has a NHL job, whether it's starter or backup, locked up for this year at least. But I can see him sitting once in a while simply to bring another goalie in to try them. I can see bringing, you know, on a back-to-back perhaps, bringing up Ordeo or bringing up Waugh, just to give them some time in an NHL net. Yeah.
Well, the only time that I'd bring Ordeo up is likely towards the end of the season, or if there's an injury. You know, just because, you know, you might as well see what Ramo and Berra have over the duration of the season. Because, like, you can make evaluations heading into next year. Like, if Ramo's very disappointing all year, then you can, like, try to move him out somehow.
Well, if he's disappointing, that's going to be a tough contract to move.
Well, like, I'm meaning, like, go back to Russia type of thing.
Ah, okay.
It's one of those things that it's a good problem to have. Like, it's better to have that than, oh, God, each goalie's giving up 6 goals every game. So, you know, basically Edmonton's problem. So,
yeah,
you know, it's always better to be on this end instead of having no goalie prospects at all.
Oh, for sure. And I think for a team that has, for years, it's been said that the Flames had nothing in the cupboards. The cupboards have been bare. I'm pleasantly surprised to see what we're seeing out of a lot of these players. Guys, you know, for a team that they said, hey, there's no prospects here worth anything, all the pundits, to see what we've gotten, to see what our prospects are giving us, I think that's really a telling sign.
Well, a lot of people back in July when I was making such rave reviews of all of our prospects at that development camp, like, a lot of people were thinking, like, I was pie in the sky, you know, overrating the prospects just because, but no, they actually are that good. And, like, you know, I'm a very critical person, so, like, I don't give praise if it's not warranted, and, like, a lot of these players are just awesome. So having that kind of depth is, you know, not even remotely normal for how the Flames organization's been the last 20 years.
Yeah.
So it's always good to have depth.
Speaking of depth and young players, a couple young players that we saw this week come up and play for the team, Max Reinhardt and Chad Billings both came up. Reinhardt's played for the team last year. I believe this is Billings' NHL debut. What'd you think of those two?
Billings, he's a good offensive defenseman, but he's still,
he seemed like he got lost at times.
Yeah, he's still got a ways to go. Like, it's good that he got his cup of coffee in the NHL, because, you know, you can learn from, oh, this is what I have to do to actually improve.
Yeah, it shows him what he has to do and what level he has to get to if he wants to come back.
Because he is only 5'10", and, like, there have been NHL defensemen that are that tall, like Tory Krug and Andrew Ferentz. But you have to be a very smart player and stronger on the puck, even though you're small. Like, you can't just get pushed off easily. And I think that's part of what the problem with Billings was. As for Reinhardt, he looked very good, and I have absolutely no problem with him. If he stays with the Flames longer term, like, you know, he should be a quality third, fourth line guy that can chip in a few points here and there and play a decent all-around game. Like, to me, the player that he reminds me the most of that from former Flames is Tom Kostopoulos. Someone that's
interesting. I was thinking something along the same lines. Yeah,
somebody that's competent with the puck, knows, you know, how to play, and can do a little bit of everything.
But a guy who's got quite a gritty sandpaper game to him, too.
Someone that can do a little bit of everything, and it's all good.
Yeah, you're not expecting too much from him. He knows his role on the team, but you know that he can come through in his role very well.
Yeah, and you need players like that. Yeah, not every player is going to be a superstar.
Well, we've said that all along. Not everybody can fill out the top six, because you can only have six guys in the top six. So somebody's got to be the 9 to 12 forwards. And, you know, some guys do it very well their whole career. And I think that Max Reinhardt's going to be one of those guys who's a 9 to 12 forward his entire career and will do a very good job of it.
And the other encouraging thing is that we have so many players that can fill that role. Like, it's not like it's just Reinhardt. Like, we got Boma, we got Hanowski, Ferland, Arnold, Agostino. Yeah. Like, you know, and I can keep going, like Harrison and several other guys. So, you know, it's always good to have a pipeline of guys that you can throw out in the third and fourth line role.
Well, and a lot of that, and I mentioned this earlier in the season, if you look at the forward depth on this team, not just the NHL guys, but even the prospects, it reminds me a lot of a Daryl Sutter team because of that. We have a lot more guys who have that gritty kind of game to them.
And you need that. Like, even one of our higher-end prospects in Poirier, like, he is a feisty, pain-in-the you-know-what. You know, like, he's already got like 100 penalty minutes this year.
Yeah. Well, I think the Flames probably realized, they probably sat down as management and said, what is it that had made us successful in the past? And realized that's what made them successful. So tried to go back to that.
And you need that kind of feistiness in addition to the high-end skill. And like what we've been seeing recently with a lot of our prospects, like Poirier's like third in Canada in points per game. Klimchuk's like sixth. And all the players that are ahead of them in each case are players that were picked ahead of them, so it looks like we got the best of the bunch.
Do you want to give us a bit of an update on some of the Flames prospects, Matt? Yeah,
and like Gaudreau, he just won the Player of the Week in the NCAA because he had 7 points in the two games on the weekend. Bill Arnold's doing really good. He had, I think, 5 points this week.
He had a four-point game this week.
Yeah, Jankowski had a couple of goals. Gillies was good. Like,
Gaudreau and Arnold's team won a game 11-0 this week. That's crazy.
Yeah, and, you know, like, you just go down the list. Like, Granlund is looking more and more like an NHL player. Corbin Knight is leading the Heat in scoring, and he had an absolute beautiful goal yesterday. Like, you know, like, you just keep going down the list, and, like, all of our good prospects are, like, either leading their team or leading the league in scoring. And, you know, like, that's very encouraging, because usually NHL players, as prospects, they're the very best players on their team. So it's always encouraging when, you know, our guys are actually putting up the stats. And, like, I know stats aren't everything, but, you know, it's a lot better to have, say, Poirier scoring 30 points than, say, Poirier scoring 15 points. So, you know, there'd be a lot more question marks with him if, you know, he only was getting, like, a point per game or below.
Well, I think there's already been some question marks around some of these guys as far as their size and that sort of thing. So I'm glad to see that a lot of them are proving their worth and proving that, yeah, what the Flames saw in them is, I don't want to say real, but that they can live up to what was seen with them.
And it's always good when players are performing at a top level. Like, that doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to develop into quality NHL players, but it's always better to be on that end than the other.
And I think, you know, we have to preface this as I usually do when we talk about these players. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I think when we're saying that they're really good or they're looking, you know, superb, we're talking about for the Flames in their current stage of this, I guess, cycle, if you will. These guys might not end up being NHL All-Stars or career All-Stars, the next Jerome McGinley. But as far as what the Flames need and where we think these guys are going to slot into the roster when they're ready, on kind of our five-year rebuild cycle we've talked about, we think that they're going to be good for this team. They might not last here for 20 years or be the next star, but they're going to be good for what we need when they're ready.
Well, like, in a lot of the higher-end prospects' case, like, they might only peak out as top-nine forwards. But, you know, that's still very necessary. Like, you need guys like Hudler and Stempniak and, you know, all those types from the past, you know, the Rene Bourques, the Glenn Crosses, you need that in order to have a successful team. So, you know, like, if Gaudreau comes in and puts up 60 points a season, well, that's very good. So, you know, like...
Well, to me, I think anyone that can have, let's call it 5 years, anyone that can maintain an NHL job regularly for 5 years, I think you can call a successful draft pick or successful prospect.
Oh, yeah. Most definitely. And plus,
even if it's a bottom, you know, even if it's a bottom three role or a bottom two role in a defensive case.
Yeah. Well, realistically, you also have to figure that the Flames are likely going to get a top six pick this year, give or take. And next year, likely the same thing, because, you know, not everybody's going to be NHL ready next year. So, you know, like, you're going to get another guy that's roughly about Monahan's caliber this year, and likely another guy around that next year. So, you know, like, getting more guys that are, like, that high-end, you know, you might have a better chance at getting a good quality first line and having guys like Poirier, Klimchuk, Berchi, Gaudreau, Jankowski on your second and third lines instead.
And those are great second and third lines for where the Flames are going to be in a couple years, I think.
Yeah, especially, like, if we're continuing on to be, like, a cup-caliber team, and, like, I'm sure that's what we're building towards, like, if those five guys that I listed off are your second and third lines, and, like, they actually develop into that cup, you know, like, hit their full development, you know, like, that's, you're looking at a team that's more like Chicago back, you know, in 09, where they had guys like Bufflin and Ladd on their third line.
Yeah, and, you know, I mean, inevitably there's going to be moves made. We're not going to have all those guys for long term here. But, yeah, I think that's going to give us a good kind of base for this team. And even if we end up moving some of them or not, I think, yeah, we're going to be in a good scenario either way for the next couple of years. And we can have the depth that's required at least, I think, within the next 5 years to make it into a postseason.
Mm-hmm. Oh, most definitely. And having that kind of a depth chart, it will allow the best players, similar to the goalie situation, like, it will allow the best players to actually rise to the top and, you know, get the best results for us down the road.
May the best man win.
Exactly. It's more about cheering for the team, the logo on the front instead of the name on the back.
You know, I heard an interesting quote this week from, I forget who it was, some analyst in Europe who was talking about the Flames, and he said, Flames fans have to cheer for the team they want, not necessarily the team they have.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's an interesting phrase. We have to look at this team and figure out what do we want, who do we want on it for long term, and that's what we have to be cheering for.
Exactly.
Well, Matt, should we wrap this show up for this week?
Yes, most definitely.
Got three games this week, and I'm looking forward to all of them. I'm hoping the Flames can get out of the bit of a rut that they're in, and maybe just Smid coming in will help with that, but I'm hoping we can put some wins on the board again soon.
Yeah, and just as one final note, get well, Stamkos. That was a truly nasty injury, and I hope you're not out that long.
Yeah, I didn't see it, but after you mentioned it, I'm going to have to go look it up on YouTube tonight.
Yeah, it was quite nasty. Anytime you break your tibia, which I believe is the strongest bone on your body, that's not good.
No. Before we do shut down tonight, I wanted to let everybody know about something that we're going to be doing. This is episode 28, and we're coming up on our 30th episode, which we're all looking at as quite an accomplishment. And we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for everyone that listens to the show every week. So we want you guys to be part of our 30th episode. If you go online to www.firesidechat.ca/feedback, you'll see that we have a list there of ways you can get in touch with us. We want to hear from you. We want to know whatever you want to share with us about the show, about the Flames. How are you enjoying the team this year? How long do you think the rebuild will last? Which of the rookies do you think is going to make the biggest impact in the next couple of years? What are your favorite Flames memories, even if not from this year, from yesteryear? Or what are your favorite memories from our show, Fireside Chat? Who's your favorite host? Whatever you want to share with us. We'd love to hear from you through Twitter, through Facebook, through email, or even leaving us a Skype voicemail. And we're hoping that on the 30th episode in early December, we're going to be able to share some of what you guys have told us with the whole community. So go to firesidechat.ca/feedback and leave us your feedback. We want to hear from you guys, and we want to put you on the air with us, either actually playing your voice or your comments through other mediums. So as usual, let's wrap this thing up by suggesting everybody come and visit us on Facebook at facebook.com/firesidechat. On Twitter, we are Fireside Podcast, and Matt and Luke both do their own live tweeting during the week, during the games, and talk about hockey a lot during the week. Matt, what's your Twitter handle?
@CagedGreat, and I actually have, I have over 20 Twitter followers now, so that's good.
Congrats.
It's growing, so that's good.
That's awesome.
And Luke is @Luke1701,
if I recall correctly. 1701.
Yeah. So,
those guys talk a lot of hockey. I jump in there from time to time. I don't talk a lot of hockey on Twitter, but if you want to follow me, I'm @DGStevenson. You can find, if you don't remember those, you can find all of our links to our Twitter accounts on the website, firesidechat.ca. And if you're not already, make sure you subscribe to the podcast. You can do that right from our website. You can do it through iTunes or Stitcher. So wherever fine podcasts are available, you'll find us there. Anything else for you this week, Matt?
Nope. Just have a good night, everyone. And thanks for listening.
We'll talk to you next week.
We are the boys of chorus. We hope you like our show. We know you're rooting for us, but now we have to go.
Fireside Chat Podcast, produced and edited by Dan Stevenson.